So welcome to this episode of Vitamin. Back in the studio with Dawn Barnett, Councillor Dawn Barnett for the Hangleton and Knoll Ward. Welcome back, Dawn. It's been a while, hasn't it?
It has been a while. So, thank you for inviting me.
Good to see you looking well as well. That's always good to see. We're going to start off with CCTV and you're in Hangleton. There's a bit of an issue there because previously you've campaigned up in, for the Grenadier to have CCTV cameras, which are now up. But you're calling for a bit more CCTV in the area as well.
It's not actually in my area, it's for the whole of Brighton and Hove because I sit on housing. I feel that the over 50s blocks need a CCTV cameras in the entrance to see who's going in and out, because there has been cases of cuckooing in those blocks with the very elderly, because they might go in there at 50 but they do reach 75 and 80. And they've been cuckooed two or three times, and I think it does need to have CCTV cameras to see who is in and out to put a stop to it. Until we get on top of this drug dealing and cuckooing, we're not going to get anywhere.
And cuckooing, for people that don't know, it's when someone takes over your flat pretty much, and they normally it's normally drug dealing, isn't it? They use it as an area to deal drugs.
To deal drugs, and to accumulate the money. Until they move on to somebody else. But we've got a lot of over 50 blocks up near the hospital, up in Ditchling Road. We need cameras for the vulnerable, for the elderly. You know, we need to protect them if they're vulnerable.
Yeah, do you think that's going to be likely?
I'm going to be asking for it at the next council meeting for housing, yes.
Yeah, and this would just be flats that are kind of run by the council, right?
So yes.
Council-owned property, obviously.
Yes, on the council-owned property, yes.
Yeah, OK, we'll wait and see what happens to that. What about the terms of the homeless bidder rights then? A bit about that. What's going on with that?
Because what's going on with that?
It's Labour supported it, didn't it?
Yes. The Conservatives are very much against that because it doesn't help the police to clear the streets. The homeless bill of rights gives them the right to beg, sleep in tents and do exactly as they want. And they're not all homeless. If you look at the people and they're sitting there just with a tent and nothing around them, they've obviously got somewhere to live. And you see the occasional one with a trolley load full of stuff. They might be homeless, but they're there to beg. I've spoken to two in Western Road and they've told me they've got somewhere to live. They actually told me they were going to be given a flat within 10 days. When I asked them if they'd be back there in the streets and I wouldn't see them again, he said, oh no, we're coming back because we can get £100 a day. And that is what it is for their addictions. The homeless is one thing, the begging is a totally different thing. It's just to supply them with money for their addictions.
Yeah, does it have any legal force? Because the police basically, you know, they obviously uphold the law. There's been this big debate about, you know, what happens if, for example, you know, tents are pitched in illegally somewhere on private property, for example. I mean, how do the
police if it's on private
intervene?
Property, yeah.
What happens when the police want to intervene, but they can't because there's this homeless bill of rights? I mean, is it just kind of a... It doesn't have any legal force, this document?
It's illegal. It's a vagrancy act.
Right.
So they can be moved on.
Right.
No matter what the council say, the police are there to uphold the law, and that is a vagrancy act, and it should be stopped.
Right.
And the thing is, the elderly and the women, they're intimidated by them. They don't want to come into Brighton because they're accosted as they walk down North Street. They're accosted as they walk along Western Road. They sit outside Marks and Spencers. They sit by the cash machines and ask for money when they're taking money out. But older people, the elderly and the ladies, do not want to come into Brighton because they cross the road to avoid them.
Yeah. And that's been passed, this bill, so it is actually... I mean, there's nothing we can do now, is it, for this, in terms of what the council have done?
It's what the Greens and the Labour have done. They voted for it.
Yeah, OK. Vacant property then, vacant council houses. I know you've been campaigning on that because, obviously, a lot of these homeless people are looking for to be housed, but there are vacant properties, 305?
I think you've estimated. I have seen proof that there are 305 empty properties, whether it be a masonette, a flat, a three-bedroomed house or flat, that are available at the moment, empty in the city. And the reason I'm being told is because of COVID, the work hasn't been done inside that needs to be done. But at the end of the day, those houses were empty. So workmen in there could have worked in that empty house, not mixing with anybody. If it's electricity, I can understand that people can't go in there. But if it's somebody that needs a new kitchen, I've bought many a house that's needed doing up. So why don't they offer these homes to the residents that are looking for a three-bedroom house or a two-bedroom flat and explain to them, you can go in now, you can get on with your decorating, you will get a new kitchen or bathroom, whatever's needed, but you could be waiting 6 months to a year. It's up to you if you take the property. And people will take it to have a roof over their head.
Yeah, and do you think the COVID restrictions, that might have slowed down the process of getting them?
Yeah, but all those properties were empty.
Right.
So there's no reason why the workmen couldn't have been in there. I live in a small close. I've got builders, plumbers, electricians in that close. They've all gone out to work and they've all managed to work. So those houses and flats and studios could have been being worked on all through COVID because they were empty properties and they're still empty. I've got properties up in my ward that have been empty 18 months and 2 years.
Yeah.
It's not acceptable. It's not acceptable.
Yeah. Is this because, I guess it's because there's a backlog of workmen trying to kind of catch up on repairs. Could that be a reason?
Possibly, but there was no reason for there to be a backlog. As I say, the properties were empty, the workmen yeah. were there, they should have been in there doing it.
Yeah. What about begging then? Because I know that's been a big campaigning issue for you in the city. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's against the law.
It depends
where you go in the city. It can get quite bad, can't it, in certain areas of the city?
Yes.
The town centre.
North Street, Western Road. We did have it up in Hangleton. I had a couple that would sit up there, but we've moved them on. They don't come back. They got a bit leery, so I got the PCSOs to have a word with them, and I haven't seen them since. But they were begging for drugs, because at the end of the day, I know those two people have got flats in Hangleton.
Yeah. What can be done? What can the police do about begging then? Because obviously they've got other priorities. I mean, it's almost kind of tolerated, isn't it, in a city at
the
moment?
It's too much. Yes, it is tolerated. It's accepted, and it shouldn't be. You know, as I say, the residents are the ones that are suffering, the elderly. Holidaymakers don't want to come down here and see that and walk up the street and be accosted. It shouldn't be allowed, I'm sorry. They want to improve Brighton and the city. First thing they've got to do is get the beggars off the street because they're not begging to live for food. They're begging for drugs. And at the end of the day, until we break that habit and until they should be made to get treatment, and unless they get treatment, they should have their allowances. Because a lot of them get over £1,000 a month because they're alcoholics or because they're into drugs. They get over £1,000 a month. That should be really knocked down. They should be given food vouchers to take into a shop with a photograph on it and only can be spent on food, not to spend it on drugs. They should go into a rehab, and it should be accepted that that's what they've got to do to get that kind of money, because all they're doing is ruining their lives, ruining the people that live in the city. It's destroying the city, and it's not helping them to give them money.
Yeah.
And I get really worked up about this.
Yes. We're going to talk about cyclones in the second half, but we can just start in this half. Stapley Road, I mean, I was unaware that there were going to be travel
restrictions
yeah. in that area. Just tell us a bit about that and we can talk about
it. What they want to do with this cycle lane in Old Shoreham Road, they now want to close Stapley Road, which leads... It's a route that goes through Hangleton, and people cut up Stapley Road to stop the huge queues that are in Old Shoreham Road. Cut up through... I go that way overnight, up through Stapley Road, down to where I live in the valley. And it's a cut through. They want to close that, which means the queues that are now back as far as the cemetery gates will be going right the way back through to Sackville Road. The lights let about 6 cars through at a time. You can be in Old Shoreham Road for 40 minutes trying to get from Olive Road to the lights at Boundary Road. And to close Stapley Road, it's idiotic. You know, yeah. They're stupid to even consider it. What about the people that live on the Knoll estate? What about the disabled with their cars? What about the parents, the mothers that have got children in the cars? It's the most stupid idea. We've got a petition going, and I think we've got...
Over 500 signatures.
Yes.
Yeah.
And I'm going to ask the people to keep signing, because it goes to ETS in July, June or July, and we need to stop them closing Stapley Road.
Yeah. What about, I mean, residents would still have access to park their cars, etc. Is it the residents would still have access to it, wouldn't they, for their cars? And
well, that's it. They live on the Knoll Estate. We've got Bellingham Crescent, we've got Egmont Road, Wilfrid Road, Stapley Road, Martin Road. That's where people's homes are. They need access to it.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more about cycle lanes and other local issues with Councillor Dawn Barnett for the Hangleton and Knoll Ward. Join us then. So back here with Dawn Barnett for the second half of the vote, and we're going to stick to cycle lanes, aren't we? Which we were talking about the first half. Just recap about Stapley Road then. So it will actually be cut off for all road traffic.
It'll be cut off. You're not going to be able to go up there.
Yeah.
And when you come down Stapley Road to join the Old Shoreham Road, you must turn left. You can't turn right. So if you want to go to Port Slade, you've got to come down, turn right, go all the way down Olive Road and back into Port Slade. It's making more congestion. The congestion is bad enough now, but it is. And they're putting another 125 houses in Mile Oak. Now, Mile Oak is joined John Dunn from our ward. There's two ways out of Mile Oak, and one is down through the village and the other is through Hangleton. The other day, there was an accident on the bypass and Hangleton was gridlocked. The whole of Hangleton, no matter which road you went to, was gridlocked because they had to get all the traffic off their bypass. All came through Hangleton. Crazy. Absolutely lunacy.
And there's going to be a cycle lane up Stapley Road then? Is that?
You can take your cycle up Stapley
Road.
Right,
okay. So that's, yeah, it's going to be interesting. So when's that going to come to committee again? You were talking about July. Right, OK. What about Old Shoreham Road, the cycle lane there in general? I mean, it doesn't seem to be that widely used.
Most people
would agree with that. So why are we sticking with that cycle lane? Any ideas why, you know, could it just be... Because it could be quite easy moved to Portland Road to Newchurch Road, couldn't it?
Yes.
Further down.
I feel actually Newchurch Road would be the better road because there's schools in Portland Road, whereas Newchurch Road, apart from the nursery...
It's quite wide, Newchurch Road, as well. It's quite wide.
It's wide, Newchurch Road. And you've got the roads on the seafront, the cycle lanes on the seafront. I'm not against cycle lanes, but you don't put a cycle lane on an arterial road. I speak to people that, even if they had the bike, they wouldn't use the Old Shoreham Road cycle lane because of the big heavy lorries that go thundering down there to the harbour, to Tesco's, to Marks's. And the same on the way back. They come out of the harbour, they join the Old Shoreham Road. And would you want your child or you on a cycle lane with them thundering by you?
Yeah. So what's to be done with that? Because I know that you said...
To remove it, first and last, remove it.
And you need Labour votes to do that, and that's probably not going to happen anytime soon.
Then that's not happening because I speak to the Labour councillors and they say to me, we're against it, but all they do is abstain, which allows it to go through, because they're not actually voting. They abstain to keep away from it. They need to vote against it. But for four times now, for four meetings, they've either abstained or voted for it.
Yeah.
It's going to put them in a precarious position in 2 years' time at the election, because if that cycle lane stays, those four will be gone.
Yeah. And it does generate a lot of mixed feeling there, doesn't it?
Yes.
By the cycle lane. It's quite dangerous by the Quick Fit Centre, by the Furniture Village. That junction's pretty dicey, isn't it?
Lethal.
Yeah.
And it's made worse with Lidl's opening. A lot of people use Lidl's. Good luck. You know, I'm glad they do. It's a new shop. I don't like to see empty units, but it has made the Old Shoreham Road lethal. And the queues go back from Boundary Road sometimes, almost back to Sackville Road, because in both directions as well, because people are in and out to Lidl's and different shops. It is lethal. It needs to be removed, that cycle lane, completely. They said it was going to be there temporary. How long's temporary?
Yeah, it's been nearly a year now. Is there going to be a cycle lane up near Hangleton as well? There's going to be new cycle lanes that have been proposed. Is that right?
I haven't heard about any in Hangleton. Right. I haven't heard anything in Hangleton.
All right, OK. Just briefly, there's Aldi's on your patch. Total Valley. There's going to be a cycle lane around there. We know that from Total Valley. What about the Aldi there then on that site? Because my mum lives in that area, and I know it's caused a bit of ill feeling.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it seems the right site because it's near major roads. So it's kind of, it's interesting.
The access is going to be coming off the roundabout.
Yeah.
And that, to me, is not acceptable. I was asked what I thought about it, and if I would meet with the people from Aldi's, I did say yes, I would, with my colleague Nick Lurie.
Yeah.
I would fall in with what plans he had, because he's working full time, and they never got back to me, but I'm against it 100%, because the access roads are not safe.
Yeah. So, but maybe, because I know that the Total Valley development's kind of been stuck at the moment because the Highways Agency are looking at the whole road layout up there anyway.
That's
so
right.
Maybe there could be ways in which the road system could be changed in order to be safer up there, potentially. And Aldi to pay for the works.
So long as it's made safe,
yeah,
then it would be acceptable, because it's a great big area up there. There's plenty of parking.
It's been vacant for a while, hasn't it?
Yeah, a long time. I would be happy with it if we were 100% sure the access would be acceptable, which is not as it is at the moment.
Yeah. I'm going to the other end of the ward now, Benfield Valley. So what's happening with Benfield Valley? Because I know we spoke about that.
That's in the hands of the planning officers. There's several things to be done. There's mountains of chalk there that they assure me that it was left there by somebody that asked them if they could store it there for a little while, and he never came back. The planning department have said it's got to be removed. That was at the end of January. It's still there now. I believe he wants to do bunding with the chalk all around the car park and plant plants in there, but I don't think that's really the suitable thing to put in there. It's all chalk. Stuff's not going to grow in chalk, is it? And he just wants to remove it to save him getting rid of it. But the planning officers, I do believe, want it removed.
Yeah. Okay, that's Benfield Valley. And what about in terms of the by-election victories with Anne Meadows getting elected
A result.
Yeah, it was...
What a result. She deserves it. She worked so hard. We all worked hard. We canvassed. We knocked on doors. We delivered leaflets. I'm so pleased Anne has got it. And the same as the young lady in Hollandine. She worked hard, and it's the best result we've had since 2007 up there.
Yeah.
So
over up in Patcham or in Hollandine.
That was in Hollandine.
Yeah, Emma Hogan.
Yeah,
exactly. Yeah, she did well there. I mean,
she done very well.
She was a candidate for the Tories for the Pavilion constituency as well, of course, at the 2019 election. Mm-hmm. So we were just talking off air about councillors coming back. It was 3 councillors per parties at the moment, because I know there's been a lot of debate about when council should kind of meet in person. It's not going to be full. Council.
Straight away. No, I don't think it'll be full until September.
Yeah.
I don't think. At the moment, it's just 3 people, as you say, from each group and the independents. But I don't think it'll be back completely into Hove Town Hall until September.
September, yeah. How's it working with the kind of the Teams or the Zoom, whatever? What was it? I think it's Teams you use, isn't it?
I hate it. Yeah. I like to sit and talk to somebody. I'm not happy with it, but it's working.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Going on to the bins then, I know that and the budget. So at the budget there, you had quite a few of your spending, your kind of campaigning priorities.
Yeah. Dog
have
bins.
Have a figure attached to it through the budget.
Yeah.
Early this year, one of those is being bins. So what
bins? They're for the parks, for dog bins, for dogs' mess and things like that. Everybody's complained there's not enough bins in Greenlees Park and Knoll Park. And we've got the money now to put more bins out in the parks.
Yeah, that's probably needed, because the park's going to be more widely used going forward, aren't they? Because of the people going out socialising, they can hug now as well, which is great. And so you can do a lot more now the restrictions.
Greenleys has always had a lot of dog walkers there.
It has, yeah.
It's always been a park for dog walkers. But what annoys me is they pick the dog's mess up and throw it over the garden walls as they walk along. But with the new bins, they're not going to have that excuse that there's not enough bins there.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Just before we finish up then, COVID-19, the pandemic, the community, is it still putting together in Hangleton and Knoll? People are going out a bit more now, aren't they? And,
they're going
the
out.
The shops up there, Grenadier, seem to be doing pretty well, actually.
Yes,
because I've been there a few times. And
I should be very glad.
A lot of independent shops there.
Pardon?
There's a lot of independent shops around there.
Yeah. I mean, we've only got one empty shop at the moment. But I should be glad when it gets back that the elderly people, we got a lot of elderly in Hangleton, and we had a lot of groups going for them. And you'd be surprised how much those elderly people are missing their groups and their friends and acquaintances that they've met. You know, you see them in the street and they're very lonely because we've had the Get Together Club, the Knoll Lights, we've had a dancing group, we've had all the little independent groups up there for the elderly. And of course, they couldn't meet. We had the multicultural group, lovely group for the multicultural group. Of course, they're lonely. They're missing the people that they see. I can't wait for them groups to come back.
Yeah, and hopefully with the lifting of restrictions, that will happen a lot more. So
yeah.
We'll leave it there for now. Councillor Dawn Barnett, thanks for coming today. All the best for the future. Thanks.
Thank you very much.